Slavă Domnului Iisus! Mulțumim Domnului pentru că în această zi am avut o mare sărbătoare, atât dimineață ca și biserică, unde am văzut persoane îmbrăcate în alb, mărturisind credința în Domnul. Bucurie însă și seara, unde am văzut atâția copii îmbrăcați în alb, mărturisind și cântând despre nașterea Domnului nostru Iisus Hristos. Și noi trăim prin credință, nu numai prin vedere. Și în această seară, prin vedere, noi am văzut o anumită cântare, am văzut o anumită manifestare prin vederea copiilor. Prin credință mi-ar place însă să-i văd în 10 ani de zile în apa botezului îmbrăcați în alb, prin credință să-i vedem cântând parte din corul mare al bisericii, prin credință să-i vedem oameni credincioși, parte din biserica Domnului. Și asta este rugăciunea noastră, ca și părinți, ca și biserică, Dumnezeu să îi binecuvânteze. În această seară, pentru câteva minute, voi avea câteva cuvinte în limba engleză pentru acești copilași. If I could have your attention, all of you beautiful children, I will be speaking a short message on the meaning of Christmas, and it is based on Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. And if we could put it on the screen, it will be wonderful. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and finally, the Prince of Peace. God becoming human is the message of Christmas. God becoming human is the greatest miracle, in a sense, that could happen on planet Earth. Not only that, but you see, when God took our nature, it was, in a sense, the fallen nature, not the human that God created. Jesus took the nature that we have because of what happened in the Garden of Eden. So therefore, in a sense, when Paul says that the incarnation of Jesus is a great mystery, that is a reality. And that's the meaning of Christmas. God, according to Isaiah 9:6, became a child. So I would like to call your attention to this verse tonight. And first of all, let's pay attention to the first part. For unto us a child is born. Unto us a child is born. What we see in this passage is the humanity of Christ. We see deity, we see divinity becoming a helpless baby, someone that depended on parents, someone that depending on people to be fed. A child has been born, Let us remember what happened 2,000 years ago in the town of Bethlehem. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. Let us remember a little bit and see how this prophecy came into fruition. First of all, as we remember Christmas, as we remember the child that was born, let's pay attention to the parents. Because you as children and all of us, we have parents. And Christmas should teach us a great deal about parenting and how children should respect and possibly honor their parents. Joseph, the young carpenter, he's faced with a dilemma. There is his common sense which basically tells him that cannot be possible. How can a young virgin, the one to whom you are engaged, be pregnant with a little baby and is from the Holy Spirit, is from God? That is the message, but Joseph, it doesn't make sense to him. But you see, when things don't make sense, God has something to say. And many times we are faced with this dilemma. Either we choose common sense or we choose what God says. And I am glad that the father of Jesus, the stepfather of Jesus, Joseph the carpenter, chose what God says versus common sense. Let's remember a little bit about Mary. Blessed are you among women, not above women. That is the message from the angel. And then when her cousin Elizabeth sees Mary, she says, blessed are you among women, not above women. She was blessed indeed. But you see, as we remember Mary, the mother of Jesus, let us remember what Jesus said. We are much more blessed than Mary if we listen to the word of God and we put it into practice. So yes, we remember the child that was born in the family of Joseph and Mary, and we are blessed. You see, Mary carried Jesus for 9 months in her womb, but I am blessed because I can carry Jesus, not for 9 months, but for many years, for eternity in my heart. And all of you can carry Jesus in your hearts. Yes, we see in this passage a child has been born, and we remember the parents of Jesus. We remember the people that were present when Jesus was born, when the child was born. Who were the first one? Probably the shepherds, those people tending their sheep and lambs and goats. They ran fast and they checked if the message from the angels is true. They left everything behind. They left their work, their job. And in that very moment, they went to Bethlehem to worship Jesus. And that is the message for us. I'm supposed to leave absolutely everything behind to go and worship the child that was born. And then the wise men came. The wise men. And as we remember the child and the wise men coming and worshiping him, the message is, wise men, wise children, wise people still search for Jesus. They are still searching and seeking for the Lord, for Jesus. Yes, a child has been born. This is the humanity of Christ. This is the great mystery of God becoming a child. But you see, as we move on into the passage, we observe the secondly, that unto us a son is given. A son is given. Because Christmas did not become in Bethlehem. The message of Christmas did not become in Bethlehem. It was a son who was given. Prior to being a child, prior being a baby, Jesus was a son, the Son of God, part of the Trinity. Whose son was it? Who gave him? Because that's what the verse says. Unto us a son is given. Whose son? Who gave him? Why was he given? Those are all good questions. And I propose to you that the best answer is John chapter 3 verse 16, where it talks about the Son. For God so much loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish. So unto us a Son is given. Given by who? By God. Given to who? To us. Why? So that we may receive him. That is the essence of Christmas. That's the message of Christmas. God gave and we receive. John chapter 1 verse 12. He came to his own. His own did not receive him. They rejected him. But to those that received Christ, God gave them the right to become the children of God. That is the message of Christmas. What God gave, we must receive. We must receive. But as we move on into the verse, we are told in a beautiful description in here what type of child this is, what type of person Jesus is, what type of son we have in this verse. And let's pay attention a little bit to those five amazing qualities of Jesus Christ. Number one, he is wonderful. El este minunat. Doi, el este counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Jesus is wonderful. Jesus is wonderful in his birth. Jesus is wonderful in his life. Jesus is wonderful when you observe his death and then his resurrection. Jesus is wonderful in all his words, in all his works, in all his ways. He is wonderful. Jesus is wonderful. In the 4th century, there was a man in present-day Turkey by the name of Nicholas. Anyone named Nicholas in here? One, two, three. No Nicholas. Nikki, all right. He was a bishop. He was an amazing man. He even went to one of the councils and he debated for the Trinity of Christ. Nicholas, the Bishop of Myre from present-day Turkey. Nicholas was a very rich man. He inherited a lot of money from his family. And when he became a bishop and God called him to defend Christianity, he spread his wealth. He gave his money to the poor. And he became sort of a legend in church history. And then down the centuries, people came up with what's called Santa Claus after Saint Nicholas. And we have this conception, at least the society, not us, okay? We don't believe in Santa Claus, but there is this ideology where there's this guy dressed in red with a white beard coming from the North Pole, coming and giving gifts. Well, let me tell you something that I read, a very beautiful poem. And I just took certain things because it's a long one. I don't have the time to read the entire poem. But please pay attention. How wonderful Jesus is compared to this ideology, with this myth that there is out there, Santa. Number one, Santa resides at the North Pole. Jesus is everywhere. Everywhere. Santa rides on a sleigh, Jesus on water and the wind. Santa comes once a year. The ideology, the myth, Jesus is an ever-present help. Not once a year, absolutely every day. Santa comes down a chimney, uninvited. Jesus knocks at the door of your heart. He's not interested in your chimney, he's interested in my heart. Santa rides at night. Jesus' time is during the day because he came to be the light of this world. Jesus Lumina Lumi. Santa has a belly like a bowl full of jelly. Jesus has a heart full of love. Amen, amen. All Santa can offer is ho, ho, ho. Jesus came to give us hope, 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 hope. Santa says, you better not cry. Jesus says, it's fine if you cry. Come unto me. All of you are heaven-led, and those who are tired, and I will give you rest and peace. Santa puts gifts under a tree. Jesus became a gift and died on a tree. That's what the Bible says, at least in King James Version. It doesn't say a cross. It says Jesus died on a tree. Indeed. Jesus, compared to this myth, with this ideology that we don't believe in, Jesus is wonderful, is wonderful. Number two, according to this passage, Jesus is a counselor, someone who gives advice, someone who tells you, just like a GPS, where to go, when to stop, when to start, and when to go a U-turn. Same deal. Now, it's even better, even better. You see, in order for someone to qualify as a counselor, he needs certain qualifications. Number one, does he have the experience? Does he have the age? And I'm telling you, we live in a day and age where we have a lot of mental issues. People have a lot of issues with the head, with our mental health. And more than ever, counselors, you are referred to a counselor, someone who is going to tell you what to do. Does he have the experience, the age, the knowledge? Is he available? Does he have perfect advice? When Jesus is referred as a counselor, does he have the experience? He's been around for how many years? Advising and counseling people. How many years? Thousands. Eternity. It's the same Christ who told Noah what to do. It's the same Christ who told Moses what to do. It's the same Christ who told David what to do. He's the same Christ who told Mary and Joseph what to do with the baby Jesus. The same Christ. Throughout eternity, advising and counseling us and telling us what to do. He shall be called Wonderful Counselor. I'm telling you, our problem is that we listen to the wrong counselor. When we fell into sin, when you look in Genesis chapter 3, what you see humans listening to the wrong counselor, to the wrong advice. We fell into sin because we listened to a wrong counsel, wrong advice, but we are recovered from sin because of the mighty, wonderful counselor, which is Christ Jesus, telling you what to do. This is the message of Christmas, and oh boy, I enjoy it. I love not only Christmas, I love absolutely every day when Jesus is my counselor. Question for you children, and I have your attention. What does Jesus tell you to do as a child in your family? Go ahead. All right. Go ahead. All right. Good. All right, so Jesus is speaking to you, telling you what to do, listening to your parents. He's counseling you. He's giving you advice. And what is Jesus telling us as parents to do? Okay. To love you, okay, to feed you, to take care of you, to work hard, right? Go ahead. All right, to love you, yes, we do. So let's make a deal. As Jesus is giving counsel both to the parents and to you, are we going to make a promise that we're going to listen to the advice we get from Jesus? All right. Do you guys have a Bible? Your parents brought you a Bible, yes? And you open that Bible and you're going to see certain words written in red. Red. And red is the color of Christmas, isn't it? Okay, now let me tell you something. Those red letters is the counsel that Jesus has for you. Those red letters are the words of Christ counseling us, dându-ne sfaturi. Dumnezeu să ne ajute să ascultăm de cuvintele Domnului. Mighty God, and because time is flying, a mighty God, you see, we are facing powerful, strong enemies. They are mighty. When you talk about sin, sin is defeating a lot of great lives. Sin is an enemy, is a foe. Sin is not a friend. And we defeat sin, which is powerful, only through the mighty God. I love this description of Christ where he's called mighty God. Because as I am dealing with those mighty foes and enemies, sin, the devil, death, and on, I need this mighty God. I love this progression that I see in Isaiah 9:6. It begins with Jesus being a child, born in Bethlehem, but it moves towards the end and he's presented as a mighty God. Yes, yes, Christmas is more than just a manger. Christmas is more than just a little child. Christmas unto us is about a mighty God who chose to become like one of us so that we might become, in a sense, sons of God. Let's move on. The fourth description of the baby Jesus, not baby Jesus, but the person of Jesus, is everlasting Father. And again, I love this progression that I see in this passage. First, he's a child, then he's a son, and then he's a everlasting father. Have you ever stopped to consider that Jesus, in a sense, has the tender care and love of a father? As a place within Trinity, he's the son. It's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They're all distinct. At the same time, they are being together. But in this verse, Jesus is described as an everlasting Father. Everlasting Father. Because the most, you could say, authority in the life of a child, at least back in the days, it was the Father. He made the choices. He chose, and whatever the Father said, it was set in stone. But Jesus, in this passage, he's the everlasting Father. He's the everlasting Father. And let's move on, and as we conclude tonight, a child is born. A child is born, and his name shall be Prince of Peace. Prince of Peace. Domnul Păcii. And when you go to Luke chapter 2, and you read the story when Jesus was born, the message from heaven is peace on earth, peace on earth. And sometimes at times it seems there's no peace on earth, but then the message of the angels was toward people who are right with God, people that are pleasing unto God. Different translation of the Bible puts it like, those who are the friends of God. Yes, in their hearts there is peace. There is peace. You see, Jesus came. Jesus came on planet Earth to give us peace with God. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 speaks very clearly. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ. Yes, we have peace with God. But Jesus moves on, and in the Bible we find in Philippians chapter 4, verse 7, and the peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, may it guard your hearts in Christ Jesus. Yes, I have peace with God, but then I have the peace of God in my heart. And not only that, but the Bible moves on, and it tells us that we, through Jesus Christ, we are at peace with ourselves. We are at peace with ourselves. And fourthly, we are at peace with others. With others. Are we living in peace? Are we living in peace, as I said, with the Father, with ourselves, and with those around? A fact of the human life is the fact that we die. People die. And when they die, we have a message here in America. Rest in peace, R.I.P. And basically, whether he was a Christian or an atheist, whatever humanistic or whatever he was, whether we believe in the peace in the afterlife or we don't, that is the message in America. Rest in peace. And that's a good thought, that's a good greeting, at least on the part of us, for the one who deceased. But you see, as a society, we are kind of transfixed on resting in peace. But I wonder if we have this message of living in peace. Of living in peace. Why do we only rest in peace? Why can't we live in peace? Why can't we live in peace with God the Father? Why can't we live in peace with ourselves? Why can't we live in peace with those around us? At least you could say that the job of Christ was to bring peace in the lives of those that love him. And I want to conclude with something beautiful. Something beautiful from the Bible. Jesus was born. Christmas is built upon a beautiful intentional paradox that the birth of a homeless child should be celebrated in our homes, in our hearts, because that child, homeless child, was Jesus, the Son of God. Jesus was born that we may be born. Yes, he became poor that we may be rich. There was no room for Jesus when he was born. But at the same time, you find Jesus Christ saying, I'm going back to heaven, and I'm going there to prepare a place for you, because in my Father's house, there are many rooms. We had no room for him, but yet he's preparing so many rooms for us in heaven. You see, children, you did a good job tonight, praising God. But the message of Christmas is Christ in your hearts, Jesus in your lives. And as I'm looking at you, and I'm looking at all the children of our church, I know very well, myself having 6 children, that you are not too young to sin. You are not too young to sometimes tell a lie, although we hate it as parents, but lo and behold, you guys look like us, and you follow us. When we were kids, we did the same thing. You are not too young to choose sometimes to disobey, aren't you? You are not too young sometimes to be angry and to hate your little brother or your big brother. You are not too young sometimes to tell a lie. You are not too young to choose to disobey your parents. So if you are not too young to choose all those bad things, we believe tonight that you are not too young to receive Jesus Christ in your heart. You are not too young. Be it 6, 7, 8, 9, or 10. You are not too young. You are not too young tonight to receive this child who's a son given, who's a wonderful, who's a counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. At the same time, we are not too old, again, to receive that Christ in our hearts. We are not too old. We have not way too many sins or something in our lives where there's no room for Christ to come in and cleanse our lives and give us a new hope and a new joy and a new future. May the Lord bless us. Amen.